In recent seasons, respect for Senna's genius had returned. In turn, the motivation had mellowed. His relationship with Adriane had deepened. He was relaxed, he was happy, his perspectives had broadened. And as a Williams drive beckoned, family in Brazil still remained a priority.
Right now I have my nephew, I have my niece. The difference between a man and the tubes, as you grow up, you start to have more things to think, more things to worry about, and you lose a little bit of enjoyment in life. So it's important to, whenever you have the opportunity and the place, to go back a little bit like a children.
I learned a lot from him, but I could see he learned a lot of me too. He learned maybe to see the life sometimes in a different way. And I tell you, I mean, I remember when I arrived in McLaren, he was so much focused to the job that it didn't go well already. He was too much. And then with me, it doesn't mean he has to work less, but he has to laugh, he has to enjoy a bit more. And he started to take this experience and he used it, and I could see he got even much, much stronger in this way.
A possibility for Ayrton to join us re-emerged towards the end of 92, primarily led by him. And I won't forget this because we had a winning car at the time, although I remind myself that winning cars are never dominant for very long in Formula One. And Ayrton very much wanted to get in the car for 93, and he just never left me alone. I mean, he was very persistent, very tough-minded. In fact, I occasionally was frightened to go home because the phone would never stop ringing. He knew I was there, so I had to answer. And I get half an hour's conversation, mainly on his side, of why he thought we should put him in the car.
In 94, he arrived. The long-awaited partnership was on, but Senna failed in the first two races. Round three of the 1994 season was Imola, where all the drivers had to come to terms with the death of Roland Ratzenberger in Saturday's qualifying.
He was very preoccupied on Saturday afternoon and evening, and indeed Sunday morning. But Sunday morning he was reasonably relaxed. The last time I saw him was when he picked up some spare overalls and said, "I've got to go and see Gerhard," and trotted off out of the debrief room in the truck.
I had lunch, you know, at the Renault motorhome, and went out of the Williams motorhome and just saw me, and he made a sign, which everybody was very surprised, because normally he does not, if he talks to me, okay, if say hello, if I cross him. But in the past, I mean, he would never do that, you know, just stop. And then when he saw me, he just made a sign and he wanted to talk to me. And I was very surprised too. But in the morning, he made a very nice statement in TV, in French TV. But he did not have his normal attitude. Was very, you know, proud and sure of himself. He was a bit different.
So Ayrton Senna came here to Imola and the San Marino Grand Prix in a rather beleaguered frame of mind. Two races gone, no points scored. Everyone has their own thoughts about how that Sunday unfolded. I recall standing here in this position on the grid, introducing grandstand, with the thought that this was the race where Ayrton Senna just had to deliver. And earlier in the week, that had been Ayrton's mood as well.
We are here in this third round, the European season starting now, starting from zero. So basically our championship starts here, 14 races, not 16.
Ayrton Senna in pole position, Michael Schumacher next to him on the grid.
I think particularly this circuit is very suitable for the Williams, Renault, Senna team.
And I believe, one of the other big differences that we have here for the third race of the season is that the Imola circuit is the first really fast circuit the 1994 World Championship has come to, with a top speed approaching 205 miles an hour.
Tactics for the race then, and ambitions for the race are what? flat out. Absolutely flat out. I finished third lap.
So now, with just seconds to go, the grid is being cleared, and we will soon see the cars going round.